Kernstown. This is a new game by Revolution Games, apparently the fourth volume in their American Civil War series, which kind of surprised me. I like Revolution Games. I thought that was keeping up with their releases. I don't know, how could I sleep through the previous three volumes? So this is the first game that I tried in that system. It depicts two battles on a single map, one the first Kernstown 1862 and the other one a second Kernstown 1864. We are of course in the American Civil War, two players mainly, one side is the Confederates, one side is the Union, but the game is 100% playable in solo, and that is the way I played it, playing both sides at the best of my possibilities. Yes, there is an element in which you, if you play against an opponent, you can choose certain events secretly to spring on those surprises on them, and you miss that, of course, but at the same time there is enough other randomness that I found myself that having a lot of reasons to be interested and surprised, having a lot of constant unexpected situations emerging without having to miss, without feeling sad that you didn't have those events. In fact, the way I did it, I randomized all of the events, and so actually that did even more fog of war. So, Kernstown, fairly, I don't know, complex, not super advanced game, but there are a couple of concepts that maybe because I didn't see them before were a little bit daunting at the beginning. Not a war game for beginners, I would say, but not even one of the most hardcore out there. Maybe, you know, level 2, second year of your master degree in your wargaming, this could be the kind of game that you should be playing. Let me show how the game works. This is the map of the game. It lays flat on the table quite easily, even though it is printed on paper. I like the way it looks. It is functional, but also very modern, but somehow it has a certain, I don't know, old school vintage feel to it, which I really like. Ignore those units that you see there for now. I place them there because we'll use them later to see how the game works. Now, to give you a general sense, the game comes with two scenarios. One is the first Kernstown, which I set up, but I didn't play because it's a small affair and I was very excited to play the main game, the main situation instead, which is second Kernstown. In that scenario, actually in that battle, which is depicted through several scenarios, what we're going to have is the Union defending mainly here in the central area, and we have waves of Confederate units coming from here, from that side of the ridge, from the ridge itself, and then here from the central area, later from here. So at the beginning, the Union doesn't have too much of a hard time defending, but after a while, the Confederate pressure becomes considerable. As I said, the game is divided in different scenarios, so victory conditions will be based on the scenario that you decide to play. Now, to move a little bit closer, the game is a chit pull game. That means that the units on the board will be activated when chits are randomly drawn from the cup. There's a lot of stuff that goes in this cup, more than in other games of this kind. You have Fortunes of War and Fog of War chits. The Fortunes of War will cancel the next chit. The Fog of War will create a range of weird and unexpected stuff. You have an overall commander that can activate any of your brigades. You are gonna have random events for the two sides. But ultimately, the real heart of the game comes when you draw these chits here, which are the divisional commanders. Now, the game, the units in the game, yes, they are divided in divisions, and then each division is divided in different brigades. And as you can see, each brigade has certain activation markers that they use to keep track of which of the brigades that already activated. Suppose, for example, that I'm drawing from the cup and I draw Mulligan. That means that now I can activate one of the brigades in Mulligan's division, and I look at this one here and I see that I have Harris and Linton that haven't been activated yet. I decide, suppose, to activate Harris. So that means that I can activate units on the board that are under Harris. As you can see, these chits have on one on the top the name of the divisional commander, and at the bottom the name of the command of the brigade commander. So I can activate all units that are under Harris that are on the board. Also, when I activate a brigade, I need to roll a die, and I need to roll equal to or lower than the command rate of the divisional commander. If I roll equal to or lower than, then the brigade can activate fully. They can do a lot of different stuff. Otherwise, they're stuck. All that they can do is fire combat. Which, you know, once the battle reaches its climax and units are next to each other anyways, just firing is not that bad. But again, I like that element of uncertainty that you don't know exactly whether or not your brigade commander will be able to act as much and in the fashion that you want. After you activate the brigade, you flip that marker face down, and if there are still brigades in the present divisional commander division that haven't activated yet, then you place the chit back in the cup. This is unusual. And suppose that later I draw Mulligan again, then this time I activate Linton, roll the die, determine the usual things, and then this. And at that point, Mulligan doesn't need to go back in the cup anymore. And we continue like this until all the brigades have been activated. And that is how a turn ends. Well, yes. Now, let's take a look at the map. As I said, I have placed some units here to give you a little bit of a sense of how the game works. As for the units, you have artillery that actually acts independently. As you can see, it does not have any divisional restriction. In fact, each turn opens with an artillery phase in which players alternate activating hexes in which they have artillery, and an artillery unit can move can fire. And then we have infantry, we also have cavalry, which may be mounted or unmounted, as you can see here on top, the brigade commander Lewis and Jackson in these cases here. The number that you see here, the number in the bottom left corner is strength points. The letters and symbol next to the strength points indicate the type of weapon that we have, rifles, mixed guns, etc., etc. And the number here in the corner is the cohesion rate. There's no movement allowance indicated on the counters. For artillery, it is always 6. For the other units, infantry and cavalry, it depends on the kind of order that the unit receives. So, as we said, we draw chits and we activate units when we draw the divisional commander and they decide to activate a center brigade within that command. Suppose that now we're activating, we drew Thoburn, then we use him to activate Ellie, we roll the die and we got a full activation. Now units under Ellie's command can act freely. A unit can first fire, then move, and then if adjacent to an enemy conduct close combat. To fire, the unit needs to be within range based on the weapon that it has, needs to have line of sight. Units in the same hex or adjacent can combine fire against the same enemy. And to resolve combat, you use this combat table here, which I found daunting at the beginning, but then I really learned to like, because you can apply it to actually every type of combat in the game, just using then different modifiers and other elements. What you do, first you find the column that corresponds to the strength points, the number of strength points that you're using to fire, as modified possibly by range. Maybe you're using only 50% of your strength points or 25%. Here, you cross-reference type of weapon with range. So once you have the column, then you look at these modifiers and you may still need to shift it right or left depending on things that happen. Finally, when you have the correct column, you roll two dice and You read the red one first and the white next, so you read them as tens and units, so we have 65 now. Ooh, very good. And you cross-reference the column that you're using with the result that you had. Suppose we're fine with 8 points. This is the result, and you're thinking, what does that mean? It means that if the cohesion rating, remember, cohesion rating, bottom right corner, of the unit I'm firing at is within that range, that unit will need to take a cohesion test, and the color of the band within which the unit's rating is indicates the type. Green is routine, yellow is tough, red is severe. So for example, if the result is this one, the -013, that means it's a miss against this unit because the cohesion rating of this unit is not found there. If the result is this one, then my unit with command rating of 4, with cohesion rating of 4 will take a routine test. If the result is this one, then my unit with 4 will take a severe cohesion test. And the table for cohesion test is on the other side. And you have one for fire combat and one for close combat. Again, you roll these two dice. And the red, you use it to determine the depletion result, and the white to determine the skedaddle result. So you use the table, or within the table, you use the section that applies to the type of test you're taking, suppose it's tough, and I rolled a 3, then I have a depletion. A depleted unit is simply flipped to its battle-worn side, which of course means worse stats, and a little bit closer to breaking. So this is what you find here, whether the unit depletes is depleted or not, and yet you have actually a variety of things that may happen. You may have to retreat a number of axes, the unit may take a morale hit. The first morale hit shakes the unit, reducing strength points and the cohesion rating. The second morale hit disrupts the unit and inflicts even a bigger penalty on strength points and command rating. Also, some results may be break test, and also you have to take a break test pretty much every time that you take a morale hit and you already have the maximum, you take a depletion and you already are depleted. At for the break test, you roll a die on this table here. If you roll equal to or lower than the cohesion of the unit, well, you just stay the way you are. You are not. You don't break. Otherwise, if you're broken, your unit is removed from the table, and that happens if you roll more than your cohesion rating. And broken 1, broken 2, broken 3, simply, the higher the level of how much your unit is broken when removed from the table, the longer it takes before it becomes available for you to rebuild it. That's for fire combat. Then the units can move, ole, and that's pretty much self-explanatory. I didn't talk about the orders, and that's important because of movement. So when you activate a brigade, before you start firing, you'd better issue orders. Orders to your units. The orders are attack, defend, maneuver, or regroup. As you can see, the movement allowance changes depending on the order that you give to that brigade. And simply attack gives a lot of flexibility, allowing you every type of attack, but you cannot recover or rebuild. Defend still gives you the possibility of engaging and even of firing, but gives you less mobility and allows you to recover, but not to rebuild. Maneuver. It allows you to move the fastest, but nothing else, no rallying, no attacking. Regrouping, 0, the units that receive the regroup order don't move at all, and all that it can do is to recover or rebuild. Recovering is when you're trying to recover from disruption, you're trying to remove morale hits, you're trying to rebuild units that broke earlier and that have been removed from the table. Finally, rewind to where we were. You fire, then you move, and then at that point, if you move adjacent to an enemy unit, you may declare close combat. The target unit gets to fire at you first, so that's painful, as it should be, especially if you are charging an enemy unit across open field before you reduce them and you shake them. That's, you just get what you get, and you get pretty much what you deserve. Anyways, they get to fire at you with normal fire, but of course a very close range, and then you resolve close combat, which is resolved, again, on our very reliable and serviceable combat table, using the total strength of the attacker with modifiers based, for example, on the ratio between the attacker and the defender, greater cohesion, and then terrain, position, and possibly if special events, etc., etc. So again, you'll reach a certain column, you will roll, and you'll see the type of test that the target unit may have to take. Actually, in the cohesion test, there is all, in the close combat, there is always going to be a cohesion test. It is just that if this table doesn't give you a cohesion test, say the result is this one here, the dash, then you still roll on the cohesion table for the close combat, and if again there was no negative result for the defender, then you roll on this table, which actually, plot twist, gives you results that may apply to the attacker. For example, attacker is depleted. So again, if you don't inflict damage on the target, you, the attacker, may take damage, and it may happen also in other situations, but especially here. And so this is what you do. You take a test now on this table here, again, with both depletion results and skedaddle results. And I would say this is pretty much it. I mean, the rally action allows you to, as I said, you need to, sometimes you can automatically remove morale hits. If you want to rebuild units, you have to roll a die. It's a little trickier. But this is pretty much the general idea. And I know it sounds like a lot, but you draw chits from a cup. You activate a division and you roll a die to see the division activates fully or only performs fight combat. You give them an order that doesn't have momentum, doesn't engage, doesn't commit you to what you're going to do next turn, simply defines the kind of activities that you can perform and the movement value of your units. Fire, then possibly move, then possibly perform close combat, then possibly rally. And that's about it. And that's how you play Kernstown. So this is the first game that I played in the system, and as I was learning from the rulebook, there are a couple of passages that I struggled with. I sent a message to the designer, it was very nice, and clarified my doubts and also explained that some elements, yes, maybe in the rulebook, he assumed knowledge of previous games in the system. So may not be the best game to start with the system, but hey, if I did it, so can you. And I like the system very much. Wow. It's a game system that, yes, I had not seen before, although I'd seen similar things. I like chit pool games. I love the variety of the action that they generate. The fog of war, the unpredictability makes these games very friendly to the solitaire player. And in general, just makes gameplay so much more interesting. And so chit pool, the basic idea is very simple, and yet different games will implement it differently. And I like this one. I like the idea of the divisions that come back and they hit the brigades until they're exhausted, plus a lot of other random events, plus even when you activate a brigade, you don't know if it's a full activation or limited activation. I like the level of uncertainty. Again, there may be too much chaos for some of you, but to me, that is just right. I want that element of uncertainty when I play war games because it captures the messiness of warfare as we know it from history. Other elements in terms of gameplay, I like a single combat table. And again, that the fact of the you roll on a combat table to see what kind of test you're gonna take felt a little bit fiddly at the beginning until I started playing it, and then I really enjoyed that you have that single idea. Three types of tests, each of which, by the way, has two columns. So actually, there really is a large variety of outcomes, and I found that I like that very much, that in many other things, it's like you take a damage, or take a damage and retreat, but here you have situations where you retreat and don't take damage, you take physical damage, but not moral hits. And so some people died, but the other people are still in high spirits. Or you take mortal hits and retreat, but you don't actually take too much physical damage. That, again, added more variety to gameplay in a way that it turned out to be actually gameplay-wise very economic, very, very manageable, very streamlined. One combat table, two systems of cohesion tables, and that's all you needed to really create a large number of situations. As for this game specifically, this incarnation of the system, then you have a really interesting map because there is a lot of terrain that is well interesting. You got that ridge on one side, a lot of changes of elevation. On the other side, in the center, you have sort of this highway of clear terrain, very tempting, very appealing, because you can move fast there. But then, of course, when you get shot at in that area, then it's not nearly as protective as other areas are going to be. And so that gives you, the kind of map gives you a lot of interesting options, as you can go for the obvious solution, or you can try some maneuvers around, try to outflank the opponent, elements that are also important in traditional warfare and the American Civil War. So interesting here, because the highway, in a certain sense, the flanks are anchored by terrain, but if you invest enough, you may still be able to do that, to be able to concentrate forces on the flank. In general, the action is pretty interesting because, yeah, you draw chits, but each group is relatively small. That means that you are constantly activating groups. If you were playing against an opponent, I don't think the turn of the opponent would take too long when the opponent maybe has like three chits that apply to that brigade. But then at the same time, when you're resolving combat, yes, there are a couple of steps. So I think that the pace works. It's fast enough that then you can afford adding the level of detail to combat without making the pace of the game too slow. So it's fun. I enjoyed the game. I played the basic main scenario of Second Kernstown. There are a lot of other scenarios, a lot of what-if situations that you can explore. Now that I know the system, I think I want to play more games in the system. Well, if nothing else, it's going to be easier to learn previous games in the system. I may just go back and look at some of those. It's a really fun system. The pace, the flow of the game, fire, move, possibly attack. Very basic, but you know, it's a refreshing change from fire and move, or move and fire, or only move or fire that you have in so many other games. Artillery being uncommitted to divisional command gives you again interesting options. So it's a really fun game system, and in particular, I like the battle that they found in here, because it's a battle of pretty large scope, lots of units, lots of different options going, lots of different things going on, enough units on the board that you can try a lot of different strategies, but at the same time, not to the point that the gameplay becomes unmanageable because you have too many units. So nice balance there between enough units that you can do stuff with them, but the game still remains logistically manageable. Kernstown, I enjoyed it.